So, I hope you enjoyed. I have to introduce you to Professor Nicky Clayton and Mr. Clive Wilkins. They are here to share their insights on how we keep conversation without words and how that can lead us to new ways of thinking. With you, Nicky and Clive.
Thank you all for coming. We speak with our vocal organs, but we converse with our whole body. And what you've just seen is a conversation without words, and that's dancing your words away, if you like.
It might be an idea if we unpack what was actually happening during the dance a moment ago. In fact, we could demonstrate some of this. Tango is a very passionate dance. A very interesting one, uses no language. It needs no language whatsoever. We don't use words at all in that sense. From the moment in which two dancers see one another across a milonga floor, they engage in what's called the capriccio, and it's a movement of the eyes, a gesture of the body, something ephemeral, which lets those two people know that in the next moment they will be dancing. How do we describe it? We can't use words to describe it. It's just that known fact that occurs. And indeed, once those two people come together for the first time, and they enter into the embrace, in this first moment, so much is known. The way in which a person's muscles work, their body orientation, their warmth. There are so many levels at which a communication is taking place without using language at all. It's kind of fascinating how it works. And the thing is, the movements take place using a kind of synchronicity, which is apparent to both people. We might wonder how it works. And it kind of works in a sense because there's a chess lead that the gentleman's leading. But there's so much more than this actually going on in the moment. Some key points that I want to make. The embrace is so important. But actually, there are some other things going on here as well. There's a gaze, but there's a synchronicity in knowing actually what your partner wants. In the moment that we're together, we're actually in sympathy, in unison with one another, and we're looking to see where the moment might take us. And we're doing that by being aware of how the body posture might work and how there's a subtle lead in the gentleman's chest. But thereafter, there's so much to play for. And it's two people finding an emotional response in that moment, which is non-linguistic. There's an intuitive planning, for example, that takes place in listening to the music and knowing what the end of the phrases are going to be. And both people feel it. So though there's a leader and a follower, the gentleman is usually the leader and the lady is the follower, actually, after the very first movement, which the gentleman tends to make, there's no leader or follower because you're both just working together in the moment. This is fascinating. It's probably the nearest thing, one of the main ways in which a human being can actually work without words, to actually think without using language. So the important point here is to say that there's a big cognition that's taking place in the moment.
Now, there's a sense in which we're not the only species that does this. I don't mean that other animals can do tango, literally, but there are parallels to the process that we use. And one of the examples... Well, I'll do my best. I'm sorry, I'm English, I'm not Portuguese, but I'll do my best to speak slowly, and if I speak too quickly, feel free to ask me to slow down some more. The species I have in mind is a kind of bird called the manakin, and these birds live in Argentina and Uruguay and also in Brazil. And what I want to show you in a moment is a little movie clip of these birds in action. The parallel is because, in fact, it's a dance between two birds. In this case, it's two males. There's a leader and a follower. And I want to show you just how complex their movements are.
Both are males. The female has just landed on the right. This is a double act. The female will only respond if two males perform together. But why should apparent rivals help each other? One is senior. He is the one who owns the dancing perch. Only he will mate with the female. The other is his apprentice who's learning the form. And indeed, this dance does take some learning. Young males start practicing in their second or third year. They get their adult plumage when they're four, but they still continue to dance with the younger birds as this one is doing. Only when he's eight is he likely to be taken on as an apprentice by a male who owns a court. If and when his senior partner dies, he may inherit the court and take on an apprentice of his own. But even then, he will only succeed in mating if the females are impressed by the virtuosity of his team performance.
So it's quite striking. What you see here is that movements can reveal things that words do not. Hence why the female is so good at discriminating which males she considers to be worthy dancers for her to engage in courtship with. And we also know that in tango, movement can reveal things that words do not, and at a speed that words do not. So for example, you can learn more in some ways within a 12-minute tanda, so a section of movement in which you dance tango, than you could ever do in 3 hours of conversation.
In fact, there's an interesting phenomenon that takes place on the tango floor and it malongas. You find yourself wanting to dance quite regularly with the same partners, especially if you have an empathy that goes with the moment. And you can find yourself dancing with the same person once a week, a couple of times a week, for years, and you never get to know their name. You never find out what they do, what their occupation in life is. In fact, there's no need, because the essential things about a person you get to know through the contact in the dance itself. It's a kind of curious thing. In fact, it gets to the point where you probably wouldn't want to know their name or their occupation or what they did in life, because the mystery is greater. The interest is more phenomenal. And so that's interesting.
Absolutely. And by contrast now, I want to show you another example, because, of course, movements reveal, but they can also be used to conceal. And one of our personal favourites comes from the cephalopods, the octopus and the giant squid. And what I'm going to show you here is a little movie clip of an octopus that's disguised itself as a rock. Except that, unlike normal rocks, this particular rock, because it's an octopus, can move. The moving rock trick by the octopus. And you can see it illustrated here between the white arrows. That's actually an octopus, not a rock. And if you watch carefully, you'll see that it's moving. It's not just moving, it's moving at the same speed as the waves. And it adjusts its movement based on the light intensity. It's pretty cool, I think. So there you go. That's an example of how movements not only reveal, but they can be used by clever animals to conceal.
In much the way that tango dancers might use the music to charm the moment as well, in a similar way.
Absolutely.
The interesting thing, though, is that words can sometimes constrain, especially when they're taken literally, and we can see that in this image here. This is, in fact, an inversion, where more than one thing is being communicated at exactly the same time. Now, perceptually, these things appear to us to be contradictory. But most often, in truth, they simply give us the opportunity to engage in divergent thinking, in perspective taking, if you like, the opportunity to see things from alternative viewpoints. Now, interestingly, most conversations that we engage in our everyday lives use convergent thinking, in which we choose to agree the terms that we're going to employ. We try to see things in exactly the same way. The words are a label for something that we have in common. And we also use the social mores of life and our social interactions as good behavior, which also we standardize in this kind of way. However, for creative thinking, it's good to actually trigger divergent thinking, because divergent thought is more likely to result in expressive thinking, expansive thinking, in fact. An ambiguous idea always requires further thought. And we see a perfect example of an ambiguous idea here. When used well, when used powerfully, when used to be creative, the effects can be powerful. And indeed, we've got some ways in which we can actually perhaps demonstrate that to you right now. I wonder if, for example, I could come... In fact, let me choose somebody from the audience here. Young lady here, would you help for this? You can just stay in your seat, if that's all right. I'd like you to think of a number between 1 and 99. You've got a number in your head between 1 and 99, yes? Okay, that's good. You're not to change your mind, you've just got to hang on to that number, okay? I have a pencil here, a piece of paper. I'm just going to write something on here. It's a two-digit number, yes? Yeah, between 1 and 99. Okay, that's good. Nicky, could you just hold this for a moment?
Of course.
Now then, for the first time, name the number that you're thinking of. 20. Okay. You've actually chosen 20 to be your number. Now I'm going to, sir, could you come forward? Or madam, yes, that's fine. Okay. There's a piece of paper. Don't look at it just yet. Oh, you've looked at it already. Okay. Is there a number on that piece of paper? Okay. What's the number on the piece of paper? Could you say that to the entire audience? 20. Thank you very much. So there's probably something interesting going on there. Now we're going to try something. Now Nicky doesn't know if I've planned this. Nicky, I want you to actually help. Nicky, I have here a blindfold from some airline, Virgin, I think.
Virgin Atlantic.
Could you wear that?
Sure.
And I'd like you to then turn around and face away from the audience. Okay.
Like that?
Yes. Madam, would you come up? Yes, that's it. I'm pointing to you. That's good. We're going to try a little something here. I have a pack of playing cards here. Okay. Interesting. You didn't think it was going to be this kind of show, did you? I would like you to say stop any time you like. Okay. Now, you can take that playing card and have a look at it. In fact, could you show it to the audience? Is that possible? Okay, so that the entire audience can see the card that you're thinking of. Yeah? Show it to everybody. Okay, you're going to. It doesn't matter if I see the card because I've seen the trick before. But yeah, you can show it to everybody now. That's good. Can you see the audience? Okay. Now keep that card. You can just stay there for a moment. Nicky, can you turn around and you can leave the mask on. In actual fact, darling.
Okay.
Now there's the audience and everybody here knows exactly what this card is, but the chances are you don't.
Nope.
I wonder if you could have a go at telling us what the card is.
So. I should start with the suit, right?
Right.
It's a spade. I don't like spades.
Right.
It's a number.
Uh-huh.
It's the eight of spades.
Is it? Nicky, that's so good. That's so good. You can take the blindfold off now.
Would you like that back?
Yes, okay.
Oh, I can see again.
Nicky wasn't expecting us to do that this evening. But it just goes to show she's the star of mystery. So, what exactly were we communicating just then? With and without words. Now, at this point, we could actually stop the lecture and discuss this for the rest of the meeting, the rest of the evening. Because in actual fact, there's so much going on here in this moment. But in actual fact, we need to move on, so...
Fair point. Well, the next point is that animals communicate, but they don't use words to think. After all, they don't read and write. So how do they capture their thoughts? And how do we eavesdrop to see their conversations without words? Well, we're going to return to a theme that Gustavo mentioned in his introduction. We're going to return to the waggle dance of the honeybee for a moment. And I just want to show you a little movie clip to illustrate our point.
It's a very intimate view of the interior of the hive.
Yes, it's like Big Brother for bees.
It is. It's great, isn't it, really?
Adam has set up an infrared camera to spy on the bees inside the hive. And we are hoping to see a striking behaviour that's key to solving the problem of gathering enough food. It's called the waggle dance.
Adam, look at this one. This one's waggle dancing, isn't it?
Yeah, this is the waggle dance. So you've got this lovely figure of eight dance. I'm sometimes getting in the way of other bees, but generally speaking, keeping this nice kind of rhythm going.
The waggle dance isn't just for show. This bee has found a good source of food, and she's performing a set of very precise movements to tell the others exactly where to find it.
And this is all about communicating the whereabouts of a food source.
Yeah, this is like GPS for bees, basically. They're telling other bees not just that there's food out there, which is quite a useful signal, but where that food is, so they can communicate the direction and the distance of that nectar.
But how can a dance communicate where a food source is? To find out, we need to get a better view of the horizon.
Super view, well worth the climb.
Yeah.
But what about the mechanics of this dance then?
Well, the bee that we saw dancing in the hive was doing this figure of eight, and that central section was where she was vibrating her abdomen. And when you think about it, the only frame of reference bees have in the hive is gravity, up and down. And the frame of reference they have out here is the position of the sun, or more accurately, where the sun would be if it was projected down onto the horizon, what's called the azimuth.
From up here, it's easy to see where the sun lies over the landscape, and where it would be if it dropped to the horizon. Now, our dancing bee was waggling at an angle of 5 degrees. So, if this tower were a massive beehive, the waggle dance would be telling us that the nectar is 5 degrees from the relative position of the sun. That's somewhere in that direction.
All right, that's the direction. What about the distance?
Well, that's that duration of that central waggle run, as it's called. The longer they dance for, the longer that waggle run goes on for, the further away the food is. So a very short waggle run, like we saw down in the hive, is maybe a couple of kilometres, whereas they can sometimes waggle for much longer, perhaps 9, 10 kilometres even.
So honeybees survive the winter by using what we'd call mathematics. They compute angles and distances and then communicate that information to their nest mates. It seems incredibly clever, but in fact, it doesn't involve any thought at all. You see, the waggle dance is so important to the survival of the hive that it comes built into the brain of the honeybee. Every worker bee is born with the ability to perform the dance automatically. In other words, the bees are acting on instinct, a set of behaviours that are so important to the animal's survival that they're hardwired.
Think of them as a simple set of rules that are tattooed onto its genes by evolution. It's what makes these bees do the waggle dance. The animal.
Here you see a way of using movement to communicate quite complex, detailed information, but it's a genetically coded, hardwired communication system.
And it's also evidence that there are mysteries all around us. We think of ourselves as being a clever species, but in actual fact, it's taken us 3 millennia to actually discover what the bees are doing, to unravel their pattern, in fact, to discover the code. And thanks specifically to Carl von Frisch as well. For his work, he won the first and only Nobel Prize in animal behavior, along with his colleagues, Nico Tinbergen on the end there, and Conrad Lorenz in the middle photograph. He's the man on the left in his photograph. And they observed the manner and movements of birds in order to understand what we would call the conversation without words. Now, we could actually look at corvids. These are some of the most cleverest birds around. They're remarkably clever. Their cognitive abilities are on a par with chimpanzees. Indeed, they are most recently becoming known as the feathered apes because they are so clever. Now, unlike the genetically coded communication of bees, the corvids engage in cognitively controlled, flexible conversations. And we can see an example of that going on in this next little extract, which is analogous to the tango, where we actually have two birds engaged in a little dance. There's actually a leader here and a follower. They're not just taking in the world, they are corresponding to each other, they're communicating to each other, they're showing a bond in a very rare and interesting way. And indeed, if the clip had gone on a little bit longer, we'd have probably seen an example of bill twining, where they actually engage in moving their bills together, which is very much like an embrace that you might see in tango itself.
And just as in human Argentine tango, where you have the capocheo, the look, here you also have the importance of the eyes. This particular corvid is a jackdaw, and you'll notice that there's something interesting about their eyes. Unlike most animals, they have pale irises. And what this allows them to do is to follow eye gaze independent of head gaze. Chimpanzees, for example, only understand that eyes move if they move with the head. They'd understand that from that angle, I can't see you. But they wouldn't understand the nuances of, well, my head stays the same and my eyes are looking in another direction. But these jackdaws can do that. They can follow eye gaze independent of head direction because they've got these pale irises. And they use their eyes to signal, just as we do in tango with the capocheo, even to deter their neighbours from intruding their territories, for example. As Clive pointed out, these birds are extremely clever, and they can even plan ahead. And one way we've investigated this behaviour is to look at their ability at hiding food, which is sometimes called caching, based on the French word cache, to hide. And to illustrate some of the nuances of this, I'm going to show you another little movie clip. This is one from the British Broadcasting Cooperation, or BBC, BBC Two, in fact, in a new series we've just produced called Inside the Animal Mind. So I'll show you a little bit about this. And the species of corvid we're going to focus on in particular is called the scrub jay. It's a member of the crow family that lives in the western United States, amongst other places.
There's a common behaviour in the animal world that seems to be about planning for the future. It's called caching. It's what squirrels do in the autumn, hiding nuts in the ground so they can be dug up and eaten over the winter months. But if caching were an Olympic sport, then the corvids would be the gold medalists. Most of them seem to do it, much to the annoyance of the squirrels. And this American corvid, the Clark's Nutcracker, is the caching king. Researchers have observed how every year it can store and remember the location of thousands of different seeds. This bird truly is the master of memory. But is this just another example of instinctive behaviour to survive the winter? Or is there something far more complex going on? It's a question that's greatly intrigued Professor Nicky Clayton. She studies Western scrub jays, another American corvid, renowned for its caching behaviour. Nicky wanted to discover whether they could do more than just remember where they'd buried food in the past.
If they can travel back in their mind's eye to think about the past, can they also travel forward in the mind's eye to think about the future? Can they imagine the future, if you like? Can they plan ahead?
To find out, Nicky created an experiment based on a very human annoyance: waking up to find that breakfast is off the menu. For 6 days, the birds were housed in this aviary, split into three zones. In the middle is the dining room, where the birds were fed during the day. And at either end are the bedrooms, where they were kept at night. But there's a twist. Kept overnight in this bedroom, the birds were served an early breakfast. But kept overnight in this one, they got no breakfast and went hungry until mid-morning. The birds experienced this daily routine for almost a week.
So we give them three lots of experiences waking up in the hungry room and three lots of experiences of waking up in the room that serves breakfast. But the important point is that the birds themselves didn't know which room they'd end up in on any given day.
But then Nicky changed the test. She allowed the birds to cache food in the evening, before bedtime. She placed caching trays in both the hungry and breakfast rooms. The question was, where would they choose to store the food? Nicky wanted to know if the birds could use their past experience of the two different rooms and plan for the future, namely for breakfast time tomorrow. The results left no doubt.
What we found is that the birds cache about five times as much in the hungry room as they cache in the breakfast room. They can imagine what they're going to need the following morning when they wake up hungry, so they can solve a problem before it's even happened. So what this experiment shows is that the birds can plan for the future.
So the jays' caching behaviour is far more than mere instinct. They have a grasp of the past, but can also anticipate future need and, crucially, plan for it. This skill is very rare in the animal kingdom, and it's the fourth key ability needed to solve problems.
It's called mental time travel. It's the ability to go backwards and forwards in the mind's eye. So it's about projecting yourself in time to remember the past and to imagine the future.
Okay, so in actual fact, that's communicating without words in the case of the bees, and it's thinking without words in the case of the crows.
But is it possible not only to think without words, but actually to think beyond words? And if so, how might we approach this problem of seeing the unseen, if you like? Might it be possible that we can use information we can glean from what it's like to see differently in order to at least see beyond our own current capacity?
Indeed, this is something that human beings are very good at. We have an example here of how that might take place, how it might manifest itself. I'm going to give a short reading from a book called Mustachio, book 3, in actual fact, a book that I've written, which actually deals with this particular subject matter. And here's a short extract. If only he could induce himself to see in the right way, there would be signs. He might discern and discover answers to the conundrum that gnaws deeply within him. He too easily defines his world, using things around him as markers, or totems, or proofs of what might be there and what may be beyond. The things that he experiences, the ideas he imagines, become the world that he discovers. He has a full set of equipment to make sense of the reality. Can he really attempt to understand this strange alien world that he sees and is so absurd and frequently irrational? He is aware that he takes hold of solid information and immediately reinvents it in a new form, which too conveniently, too often, merely mirrors his inner self. This crazy, overriding indulgence of his is perhaps no more than a feeble human attempt to discover ways to imagine the invisible, sneak a preview of the impossible. The answers to his questions hardly ever seem to be in what is here now. Ergo, it is always the thing beyond that which needs must be brought into reality. Sarah has slipped away into another space. What can he do in order to find her? She has become lost, as if to some other unimagined underworld, a nether place. It's too dark to see in there. And there's a second short extract, which is probably, it's a little bit more abstract, but it's probably very, very pertinent to this evening. A thought might materialize, arising like a light out of a place where there is none at all, where light is devoid and not apparent. Like the full wonder of absolute consciousness, it exists beyond and outside the manner in which we poor things think most often. Is there more than that which we see? Do we tie ourselves too readily to words and numbers to the exclusion of greater bounties and beauties? It may be that there exists elusive places in which the dance is yet mightier. Within these imagined realms may lay an Olympian tango of the heavens. rarely found, visited hardly ever, possibly never experienced.
So beautiful. Let's look at some examples of seeing differently. And the first example we're going to consider is colour. Now, most of us humans have three kinds of colour-detecting cells or photoreceptors in the retina that allow us to see, for example, traffic lights with the red, the yellow, and the green. But not everyone does. What do you think this image might look like if you were red-green colourblind? Does anyone have any ideas? Different kind of greys. So, in fact, this is what it looks like. They all kind of appear yellowish, and you certainly can't see the red and the green. And just to put up the other side by contrast, you can see the differences here. Now, in fact, there are three different kinds of red-green colourblind. And in this slide, you can see the common condition, meaning the condition that many of us have, where we have these three colour-detecting cells. And then the other three examples are cases of red-green colourblindness. You have the protonotopes that lack the red photoreceptors, the deuteronotopes that lack the green ones, and the tritonotopes that lack the blue ones. And you can see how the image changes in colours if you have those different kinds. And by contrast, so I've given you the 3 versus 2, I'm now going to go the other way and give you the 3 versus 4, because there are a number of animals, including birds and bees and butterflies, that actually have 4, not 3, kinds of photoreceptor or colour-detecting cells. So what I'm going to show you now is what a flower looks like, and the top panel will show you what it looks like to most humans with these 3 colour-detecting cells, and the bottom panel, what it looks like if you have 4, if you're a tetrachromat and can see in the UV. And here you see just how glorious that flower looks if you were able to see in the UV. I say if you're able to see because it so happens that cataract removal in some instances in human beings also triggers some people, not all, but some, to be able to see in the ultraviolet.
In fact, it's said that the very famous French Impressionist painter Claude Monet, who had a cataract operation, he knew a lot about colour, of course, and he knew the way the world looked. He'd investigated it very closely. After his cataract operation, colour was horrendous to him. His whole panoply of colour that he'd developed throughout his whole lifetime had become altered. And indeed, he had worked very hard in order to start to see with any semblance of normality at all. He had to train himself to see again. So that's an indication of how vision can change.
Absolutely, and how you can start to unpack what it might be like to see differently. Now, there's one animal in particular that's the star of the show in this regard. Does anyone know which animal has the most types of colour receptor? The mantis shrimp, absolutely. Now, they have 16 different ones, in fact. 12 of them, strictly speaking, are for colour per se, and the other 4 are for various kinds of colour filtering. Polarised light is one example.
I suppose they have to have something going for them.
Well, I guess if you're a female mantis shrimp, you think these guys are pretty cool, actually.
Yeah, I suppose that was an unfair comment, sorry.
We mustn't be speciesist.
Sorry, yeah.
But it also allows them to see things that are transparent. And how cool is that? Just think what they could do with this ability if they had our brains.
Yes, and there's other ways in which our vision can be altered. We can actually change our visions ourselves. In fact, we do in the environments that we live in. If we look at the next slide, for example, we can see here an example of a city on the left-hand side, which could very well be Rio de Janeiro, circa 1960 perhaps, and an image next to it, which is probably Vienna, 1910 or something. You might be the same person living in either one of those places. Your environment is going to affect your conditioning and the way in which you see the world and view it quite a lot. The first international-styled Rio de Janeiro is full of rectangular forms, linear forms, straight edges. All you have to do is see edges in order not to bump into things. It's a different kind of experience to perhaps living in Vienna, 1912, where we're seeing a classical environment which is highly ornamented and decorated, where there's rich symbolism in the environment itself. It's not denuded of symbolism in the way that Rio de Janeiro is. We even see absurd things like men on horses on the top of buildings, perhaps likely to jump off. Our whole imagination system is going to be altered by living in either of those places. So it's interesting. What we surround ourselves by, most often, we can be in danger of becoming.
Now, in fact, a bird's eye view of the world is very different, and not just because they can see the ultraviolet colours that we can't see. Their flicker fusion frequency is twice as fast as ours, so everything in bird world is speeded up. And they live in a three-dimensional world. And one remarkable example of this is pictured here, where you see these starling murmurations. I like to think of it almost as a kind of avian ballet in three dimensions in the sky. How beautiful is that?
So, just to create a kind of summary of this section, changes in perception alter what you see. We can see that it's a pipe, and yet the words beneath it tell us it isn't a pipe. Well, if it's not a pipe, what is it? The most obvious, the most frequent observation to that question is it's a painting. But is that all it is? In a sense, we have to alter our perception in order to make sense of it. And this is a good moment, because we can take ourselves new places. Incrementally, we can think in stages and see where our imagination might choose to take us. And I don't know, we could do it in perhaps three stages. One, two, three, four.
Qu'est-ce que c'est?
Yes, it's a question. And questions are good. In fact, they're probably even better when they don't have answers, because we'll carry on thinking about them. And of course, that's the same as it was in the flip-flop example that we showed it, demonstrated at the top end of the lecture. But these changes in perception are also constrained by the biology of how our eyes and brains view the world, as shown by the colour examples that Nicky talked about. And they're also shaped by our environment and cultural history, as we saw with the recent Bauhaus and International and Vienna example just a moment ago. In truth, our brains miss so much because we're constantly anticipating what we might see or what we might want to see, rather than looking at what's actually happening before us. I suppose we try to compensate by making associations and assumptions, only some of which may be true. And we've got an example of that, I suppose, in the next piece.
An event seen from one point of view gives one impression. Seen from another point of view, it gives quite a different impression. But it's only when you get the whole picture you can fully understand what's going on.
That's very nice. It's also wonderful if you can see it happening in your own space, right in front of your eyesight, where there is no explanation for what you're about to see. You need to watch this. Make sure you can see the piece of paper at all times. At no point must it leave your sight. Still there? Thank you very much. So these are all examples that give us an opportunity to see and therefore think differently.
That's the power of perspective taking. So this ability to constantly anticipate and create and be aware of multiple scenarios is actually really great for creativity. It's a big advantage of perspective taking.
Yeah, and we can explore that a little bit further. I'm going to read three very short extracts from the book that we heard of earlier. But I'm going to tell you up front what to look for. I'm going to prime you so that you have a chance to see what's going on before the event happens. I'm going to describe three different rooms, and in each case they're recognized as being the same one that they've always been, although on close inspection, an important element has curiously changed or seems different, causing the room's reality to be called into question, perhaps. One might ask or wonder what has changed over time. The room itself, one's view of it, one's memory of it. Undoubtedly, the established perspective has become altered. Now, the first extract describes a room that's been transported into a new building. The second extract describes a building that's been moved into a new landscape completely. And the third extract is going to describe a room that is seemingly trying to turn itself inside out. So here's the first extract. The rooms remain as they were at the time of his father's death. Various small changes or differences, such as there are, have only been brought into play by having to fit the original room layout and plan into these other rooms. They might be better suited to function differently were they given a fair chance. A few rolls of fabric remain standing in corners as of old, as reminders of something intangible. The very same old blue velvet full-length curtains stand like sentries in the window, with their resolute expectation to still be in a townhouse with a high ceiling. They're sadly out of place and incongruous in these rooms with lower ceilings and the bare horizontal lines where sky meets sea meets land that their windows look out onto. I spend time in these rooms even now and absent-mindedly might look out of the window and wonder where the skyline of red terracotta roofs, churches and spires have vanished or vaporized to, where the Charles Bridge Towers might be, or the observation tower on Petrin Hill, or St. Vitus Cathedral and the surrounding castle. And the second extract. I've been remembering recently the first time I had access to the old Count's library by myself. These were in days before I acceded to his title and before the library became my own, but briefly. The estate was to be plundered and destroyed during the last war. The library no longer exists on that site. It was painstakingly dismantled, removed and rebuilt on private state-owned land outside Moscow. I've been there a few times since, and it remains magnificent, despite all the views from the windows being wrong. And the third extract. Next door, a wakeful man, aware of time, wears two watches. One watch has stopped, and another is wrong. One is correct twice a day, and the other never is. He is sat in a chair facing the wall, whilst thinking of growing a moustache that will look like the hands on the clock before him. His alarm clock has not been set, although it should have been, had he remembered. He might have to live forever because of this anomaly. The clock behind him has one hand missing. The remaining one has been bent outwards and points into the room like an index finger making a circular accusation against him and all before it. Not one clock or watch in this room or even in the entire building, on the closest analysis, has exactly the same time on its face. No two people see the same reality. They can only choose to agree aspects of a shared one. The man who is aware of time knows all this. The wallpaper has been hung back to front, placing the entire world into a state of interior around the man, around the room.
Beautiful. Birds see more than we do. They see colours in the ultraviolet that we cannot. They detect changes more quickly, for everything in bird world is speeded up. And in a complex, three-dimensional, spatial world, we know these things. But how many things are there about ourselves that we are yet to discover? That's the challenge of Waze. of seeing further.
Turbio y trocar como un barbijo canallejo en la ciudad. Soy lo que soy porque esos tiempos eran como ellos pa' compadrear.
Questions?
Yeah, we're going to open for questions. Perguntas podem ser feitas em português, nós iremos traduzi-las.
Oh, you are there.
Just a small word about a Portuguese horse is cavalo lusitano. That dances. It's a very big animal with 500 kilos, and it dances. It dances. This audience can confirm what I'm saying because they see Cavalo Lusitano do dancing.
Good.
He's a very patient animal. I know the worldwide champion is Portuguese and he rides a white horse that dances. We are delighted with the horse.
Okay, thank you very much. That's lovely. A round of applause,
thank
I think.
You.
That's good. Thank you very much.
Any other questions?
Thank you. Any other questions?
Hi. Yes, I would like to know how did you find out about the number? And also, how did Clive find out also about the card? That was very interesting.
Okay, well, you know, I'd love to tell you.
Is it a secret?
It's not really a secret because I found out about it. But the information is out there. I could tell you, but you know what? You would all of a sudden lose interest in the whole notion of what you just saw. The modus operandi is so mundane and so ordinary that you missed it. Okay, how I dare do something like that for such a big audience as this when there's so many of you and we're all very clever. You know, I got away with it. Hands up if you know how I did it. Look at that, isn't that amazing? Now then, the interesting thing here is, now, just recently we did a similar lecture to this where we did that little bit with the number, the first part. And this little boy came up and afterwards and said, how did you know my mum was thinking of 31? And I said to him what I'm going to say to you, which is, you need to go away and spend many hours thinking about it, looking at the world around you, and wonder how something like that can be made to make sense. And if you do that, you'll have an enriched life. If I gave you the answer, you stop thinking. Because I'm not going to tell you, you will keep thinking. You need to thank me, sir. Thank me.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for that.
Sir, I was just wondering, does the tango abide to certain rules? Are there parameters? Or is it improvisation? I mean, so is there a code?
There is a code, yeah. That's part of what the lecture tonight was about. There's a code which comes from the chest. If I stand like this, I don't use all my muscles. I keep my arms. I don't use my arms at all, really. But if I, without using my hips, if I just move my diaphragm to one side or another, that's the signal for the follower. And if you think about it, not a lot of people realize this, but in the tango dance, there's only three moves. You can go forward, you can step sideways, you can step back. There's no other footstep you can make. Because it's a walking dance, it means that we perambulate left foot into right foot. And so you always know what foot you're both on, because you very rarely change weight. If you're a professional, or if you know a lot about it as we do, you do change weight quite a lot because that's a good effect. But for most people, it's walking, stepping sideways, forwards, or back, using the chest lead. Just very quickly. I'm accentuating this. I'm just showing a chest movement there, which allows us to do so much. Now, the popular notion is that the leader makes the dance. Well, that's not really true. Because when you do dancing with something as delightful as Professor Nicky Clayton, you listen to her every nuance. And I'm here to delight her. So in actual fact, we want to have a conversation together, so we think to ourselves at the end of the dance, hey, can we do that again?
But does it follow certain patterns?
Well, it's improvised.
That's what I mean.
I have no idea beforehand what Clive's going to lead. So it's not the case that we say, oh yeah, well, we're going to step forward and then to the side and then an octave and then a something else. I don't know until the music comes on what he's going to do. There are certain things that rules, as Clive said, we can only go forwards, backwards and to the side. And if I'm on my left leg and he wants to move me that way, he can't do it without allowing some sort of step first. I'm not going to hop in the middle of it. That's not going to work. And that's one of the classic problems that beginners have, is that the leader has to not only think about all these steps ahead, what he wants to do to make a dance work, he also has to think about what foot the follower's on and how that's going to work in terms of moving his follower from side to side. But within that simple remit that you can only go forwards, backwards and to the side, and there's some constraints depending on what foot you're on, the rest of it is entirely improvised.
Thank you, Miss.
I think it also could be said just that when you're learning it for the first time, there are certain moves that you do kind of learn. But if you're actually thinking about moves whilst you're dancing, you're not really dancing, because there's a thought process going on there. You are, in a sense, using words and that gets in the way of what's happening. A good dancer, good dancers, they just get in the groove, they just do it. They don't know how it kind of happens, really. And more than that, although there might be moves that you start off learning, you start to have a kinesthetic feeling experience here. You feel it in your body. And different dancers have a preference for different kinds of moves. And indeed, you forget, I can't remember the moves, to be quite honest, anymore. I simply have a signature, which is mine, which the people I dance with like, because they keep on asking me to dance. And it's the same with the followers. There's certain people I like dancing with because they have a wonderful signature. And when it comes down to it, this is something that was said this afternoon, we are all dancers. It's just that some of us don't choose to describe ourselves as such, just as we're all artists. Now, I'm a painter as well as a writer, and I often say to people, you're an artist as well. They think, oh, no, I can't do it. So I say to them, could you just write your signature down on here? And as soon as they do that, the mark making proves that they are artists too, because that is all that, you know, the linear arts are. So the only thing that painting is, it's mark making. We all do it. We just need to pay more attention to doing it when we're engaged in writing our name, even, because it says something of who we are.
Sorry, but you were talking about encoding, and you have the receiver has to know the same code of language than the one that receives. And so with tango or with any dance, you have to have a basis of the same language. You know, you have to know you go forward, you go back, you go this side,
yes,
and you go that. So you're communicating because you have already the same language.
But that's only the Rubicon. That's the starting point. Once you have something in common, then you can start real communication. I was just saying to Nicky last night, I had this clever idea for something that doesn't really make sense. It's kind of like a dream. I woke up in a dream. I'm kind of really spontaneous here. Woke up in a dream, and I had this notion that I needed a bottle of ventriloquism, which is the thing that works best if you use a bowl of fruit with it, preferably lemons. Now, I've just spouted something out to you that doesn't make sense, but it's something that I experience. And actually, although we share enough communication in common for you to go, you could say, that guy's a nutcase. But alternatively, you could show empathy and go, where's this taking us? Where does this new opening occur? You know, what is a bottle of ventriloquism? It immediately opens our minds to a new place that we can go. And is there anybody that doesn't want to go there at the moment?
No, we all want to.
You see, it's infectious.
I just wanted to comment on your very, very interesting research about the birds and the birds' dance, and they are knowing the future and knowing the past. And the other day I saw a white peacock dancing tango. It was one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen or filmed. I'm an artist myself, and I'm also dancing tango since 20 years. And I just wanted to add that at some point, very, very quickly, you turn not to think at all. And actually, I'm leading and following. I know both roles. And what I feel is that I follow the music. As soon as I'm leading, I follow even more the music. And the person that I am leading becomes also my guide, because I can only go as far as she wants to go with me. And I think that's part of the beauty, is this sort of, it's almost like a courting. And I've seen that with you, both of you, that is very sexy dialogue, and still it's so it's and still it's so intimate and so not thinking, you know. And I think that's the value of dance,
yes,
that at some point we stop thinking, that the music is actually leading our steps,
yeah,
and we forget.
Yeah, totally.
The rest.
So often people say to me, well, what moves did you do? And I say, I have no idea. And I certainly couldn't verbalise even how we moved to the music. I just know we've had this delightful experience that I want as many more of those as I can squeeze into my lifetime as possible. And it's a dialogue, but in the end we become one, and it's call and answer to the music, isn't it? So for those of you who haven't tried tango, all we can say is we recommend it.
Yeah. There's something else here, well, which I think is very interesting. It's not really about just about the dance. The dance is a fascinating thing. It's a great way of enjoying one's life and all that kind of thing. But learning the dance and learning the permutations of how one can move one's body in space opens up new possibilities for different kinds of thinking. If you're a new dancer to tango, you learn all those things that I said earlier on about perambulating on one foot to the other foot, and you can only move in three different places. But when you get more advanced, you can do all of those things in reverse. In fact, you can create a mirror image of those things. It kind of does your head in, because it's kind of complex, knowing whether you're on the parallel system or you're on the serial system. And the process of doing that, getting good at it, learning to embody it to the point where it becomes second nature, opens up new channels in thinking. It becomes a transferable skill where you can actually use it in your everyday life for other thought processes. After all, what makes a dance work? Is it the body? Is it just the need to dance? It's actually the mind, the complexity of the mind itself. And building that into a more unique structure by finding new ways in which you might articulate it, make it flexible, is only going to result in more things being discovered. Indeed, that's why Nicky and I are doing our work on conversations without words, because we firmly believe that there's new ways of actually opening up the mental processes that we all share by putting language to one side. Language has been a very important thing in the development of our species on the planet. It's made the wonderful world that we see around us right now. And it could be argued that we've got to the point in that development where we've taken it to this stage where we're almost on a precipice. It could be argued that finding new ways of thinking, extraordinary ways of thinking, things that we haven't considered before, might be a good way forward. Now, one of the most important things about us as human beings is that we can do that mental time travel thing that Nicky deals with so much. This is the present. We knew what went before. We know what's coming next. We've always thought that we do that because of our clever language skills. That's been the key to allowing us to do that. But finding that the corvids can do that, not as well as us, obviously, is phenomenal, because they are definitely not doing it with language. And that itself is a very important ingredient in the work that we're doing. And it opens up lots of possibilities. You know, if I was to say to you, have a go at thinking without using words. Initially, you're thinking to yourself, what the hell does that mean? It's a complexity, but it's one that's worth investigating.
Last question.
Hi. Can you hear me? Oh.
Yeah.
I was wondering if you know of anyone who has tried to learn the dance or the language of another species and tried to communicate something to this other species that's not a usual communication between them, and if they understood it.
Chimpanzees. The chimpanzee work where the chimpanzee is sign language.
We're just having a quick thought process about
thinking of the best way of answering your question.
I think two kinds of examples come to mind. One scientific, the other not scientific, but equally interesting. The scientific one that Clive just mentioned to me, of course, is sign language, trying to teach chimpanzees, because obviously chimpanzees don't have the right vocal equipment to be able to mimic human words. They might be able to do, I think it's mama, papa, cup is the maximum success. But what they can do is use gestures. And so there are quite a few examples of chimpanzees, and probably the most striking example of using gestures is actually the pygmy chimpanzee or bonobo. There's one called Kanzi, who's learnt Yerkish, which is our language on a computer touchscreen, and gestural commands, called Yerkish because it was developed in a place in America called Yerkes. And this bonobo is incredible. You can give him vocal commands, simple ones that make sense, like pour the can of Coca-Cola into the bottle, and he does that easily and straightforwardly. And then the woman, the brains behind this, Sue Savage-Rambo, then asked him to do daft things like take the vacuum cleaner outside. And he looks at her, and the look on his face is classic. You know, if you're anthropomorphizing, you think he must be looking at her saying, "What? Are you absolutely insane, woman? Why are you asking me to do such a stupid thing?" And eventually, when she's repeated the command a few times, he actually does it.
He does it with a sense of disgust as well, because he picks the thing up, goes...
it's really quite striking. Mm. And of course, by the same token, you can have parrots. The most famous one is a parrot, now sadly died of a heart attack a few years ago, called Alex, led by Irene Pepperberg in the States. And this parrot is a fantastic vocal mimic, but it doesn't just parrot the words back. It seems to understand them. You can ask him complex things like, there's a bunch of objects on a tray, and the goal is to take the four-cornered wooden blue item, of which there's multiple blue wooden items that aren't, only one of which has four corners, there's multiple four-cornered blue items, only one of which is wooden, and you get the pattern, and he can do the precise one. The other way of answering a question that I was thinking about is things like horse whisperers, who seem to be so in tune with their animals that they've developed a way of communicating with them, sort of taking a language that comes from the animal rather than the training the animal to use a human language. So I think, interestingly, you can get things both ways round. Very often, it's animals that have huge brains for their body size, are largely very social, and live a long time. And those are probably some of the key starting points. If you want to say, well, how do you know whether an animal is intelligent or not? They're probably the three things. And then you can start to get those kinds of communication systems in those cases. It may well be that there's highly intelligent non-social animals, but they perhaps are much less motivated to communicate if they're not very social in the first place. So, does that answer your question at all? Not really? Maybe?
In part it does. I only wanted to ask one thing, which is,
can you put the microphone, sorry?
In the end, we're going to have drinks, and you can ask directly to the speaker. Yes. Here, let's give one more round of applause for the speakers. Thank you so much.